Well, hello and welcome to St. Patrick's in Armagh. We have St. Patrick's Cathedral in Armagh, one of the most beautiful, iconic buildings, if not in Ireland, in all of Europe. We're in the place where St. Patrick had his first church. We're not far from where St. Patrick is buried. This is a special place, and anybody watching in on television, on the internet, on your mobile phone, on your computer, in the bar, wherever you happen to be, you're very welcome to join us for this first program in the St. Patrick's Festival, the Festival of St. Patrick here in Ireland, where the saint administered, really, the faith that we're living today. It's an honor to be here, and I hope you're going to enjoy it, because we've got the best Irish music for you, the great choral tradition that we have. We've got singers from all over Ireland. We've got musicians, we've dancers, we've strings, we've the mighty organ there. We're going to have a great time. One of the things I mentioned there was that this, in a sense, is the source of where it all came from. The first piece we're going to sing with Voices of Ireland here is a song called Water from a Deeper Well. And the words of it are, water from a deeper well keeps who we are secure. Faith drawn from a deep place makes our faith endure, okay? And we're going to sing that for you now, okay? Just to remind us the source of where everything came from, okay? Water from a deeper well. In a green and golden place where whispering reeds and wild flowers sing quietly with the breeze. Nearby, enchanted chains of stone, stones where once a giant's foot led siege to an ancient hill and an ancient fort. And above the soft symphony of thrush and dove and lark, faint echoes float gently in the air. For now, each one is not alone, each one is love.
Oh, I, Patrick, a sinner, a most simple countryman, the least of all the faithful, and most contemptible to many, had for father the deacon Calpurnius, son of the late Potitus. A priest of the settlement of Benavon Taberni, he had a small villa nearby where I was taken captive. I was at that time about 16 years of age. I did not indeed know the true God, and I was taken into captivity in Ireland with many thousands of people according to our deserts. For quite drawn away from God, we did not keep his precepts, nor were we obedient to our priests who used to remind us of our salvation. And the Lord brought down on us the fury of his being and scattered us among many nations, even to the ends of the earth, where I, in my smallness, am now to be found among foreigners. And there the Lord opened my mind to an awareness of my unbelief, in order that, even so late, I might remember my transgressions and turn with all my heart to the Lord my God.
That was the stunning voice of Hannah O'Brien, a member actually of one of the choirs here, the Lourdes Youth Choir. Hello. And A Christian Shield, a stunning version. Just one voice, it's all it needs if it's sung with that sort of conviction, don't you think? We're going to have a short break now, but we're going to be back with much more of the same. So I hope you can join us then. Thank you.
Patrick is one of the world's most loved patron saints, yet so much of his life is still a mystery. Who was St. Patrick? Where did he come from? Why did he have such a mission and a heart for Ireland? And where are the places we can still connect with him today? I'm going on a journey to explore the answers to these questions and walk in St. Patrick's footsteps around the beautiful counties of Armagh and Down, where so much of his ministry in Ireland took place. This is a spiritual journey, so let's push back the veil of centuries and discover the real St. Patrick.
That was Armagh City Choir, conducted by Michael Harris, with the Irish Blessing by Bob Chilcott. I love that setting of it. But I mean, the words we've all known for a very long time, "May the road rise to meet you," and so on. The last time I heard those words, I'll tell you a private story, since it's just between us and about 100,000 people. But between us, the last time I heard those words was when I had to say them at a wedding. One of my daughters was getting married in South Africa, and I had to learn the words of that in Afrikaans, which I'm sort of fluent in, you know. It was totally phonetic. And I'm not sure what I said, but whatever it was, may God hold you, that magic last line, may God hold you in the palm of his hands. There was a sort of look went around the audience, and to this day I never found out what it was I said. But we will soon find out. Now, I'd like to introduce a group now. It's not a choir, it's a family. Three sisters, brother and father, Frank, the Kelly family. And the first time I heard these people was thanks to this wonderful medium, the internet, because Frank wrote and asked me, could he take part in this program? And I said, well, you're hardly a choir with five people. And he said, well, we would still like to sing in it. Have a look at us. So I went on to this wonderful thing that young people look at. It's called YouTube or something. Anyway, and I found a video of the Kelly family singing, and I was absolutely speechless. It was just beautiful. Beisha Imkris, the Kelly family.
At the Slaney River, St. Patrick founded his first church in a barn at a settlement nearby. It was from here that he began his mission to bring the light of Christianity to Ireland, as the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, told me. What is St. Patrick's legacy for us today?
I think it's hugely important because he was the person through whom God worked to keep the church alive through the medieval period, what we call the Dark Ages. Patrick was the foundation of Celtic Christianity, of this great renewal after the fall of the Roman Empire.
And of course, Archbishop, we're standing at Saul Church this morning, the site of St. Patrick's very first church in Ireland. Mm. And a lot of people say that this is still a very spiritual place. What do you think?
It's certainly what people often call a thin place. And I think it's also a place that invites you to look outwards. I mean, you can see why he built a church here on the top of a hill, looking out over the countryside, a reminder that as Christians, we are sent by Jesus Christ into the world, not to huddle together in a sort of defensive and miserabilist clump, but to go out into the world as he did. And his world was a dark world, and to transform the world around us.
Archbishop, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Jim.
I am Patrick, yes, a sinner, and indeed untaught. Yet I am established here in Ireland, where I profess myself bishop. I am certain in my heart that all that I am, I have received from God. So I live among barbarous tribes, a stranger and exile for the love of God. He himself testifies that this is so. I never would have wanted these harsh words to spill from my mouth. I am not in the habit of speaking so sharply. Yet now I am driven by the zeal of God. Christ's truth has aroused me. I speak out too for the love of my neighbors, who are my only sons. For them, I give up my home country, my parents, and even pushing my own life to the brink of death. If I have any worth, it is to live my life for God, so as to teach these peoples, even though some of them still look down on me. I myself have composed and written these words with mine own hand, so that they can be given and handed over, then sent swiftly to the soldiers of Caroticus. They have chosen by their hostile deeds to live in death. Comrades of the Scotian Picts, and of all who behave like apostates, bloody men who have steeped themselves in the blood of innocent Christians.
To the dark.
The Garda Ladies Choir, Deus Meus Adjuvame, Latin of course, but you might have detected the odd bit of Irish in there as well. Style known as Macaronic, they would, two languages in the one song, which was the sort of thing you did, I suppose, in the early 1600s and 1500s, why not? That was the Garda Ladies. We're delighted tonight also to be able to premiere two original compositions. One of them was already written and one of them was composed for tonight's performance. The second one you'll hear sung by the Cork choirs in a moment, but first, if you'd like to welcome our very own house orchestra, Brendan Monaghan and his merry men, Brian, Brendan and Alan, and they're going to play a composition of Brendan's. And it reflects so much what this is all about. That's why I mentioned the Latin and the Irish combination, the Anglican influence, if you like, and the Irish influence. This is called, and it's a very contentious phrase in this part, in our part of the world and in our history, it's called the Planter and the Gael. And it really says it all, doesn't it? Just a wonderful choice of title, Brendan. Brendan Monaghan, please.
Thank you.
Planter and the Gael, Brendan Monaghan's stunning composition there. And I don't know what you'll make of that in the rest of the world as you're watching in, but there's a certain symbolism and significance of seeing Illion pipes, they're the Irish pipes, and the Scottish Lowland pipes playing together. There's a certain significance that we're very proud of tonight. That's the first of the original pieces. We'll be back after this short piece with a gorgeous composition by the conductor of one of the choirs from Cork, and it's called Another Pause for Reflection. It's called Reflections of Peace. We'll see you after this break. Thank you very much.
St. Patrick's relationship with Ireland was forged many years before his return as an apostle. When he was just 16, Irish pirates kidnapped him from his homeland and brought him as a slave to herd sheep on the slopes of Mount Slemish in County Antrim.
There's a very ancient tradition that this is the place where St. Patrick was held as a slave when Irish pirates had taken him captive from his home. Patrick tells us the story in his writings that one day Irish pirates attacked his father's house. We're not sure where that was. Some say in Britain, others that it was in Brittany. But Patrick was taken captive. He was abducted and brought here to Ireland, where he served as a slave for 7 years, from the age of 16 to 23. We're told by later tradition that his slave master was a druid, Miliuk, and that this whole area was very strong with the pre-Christian druidic traditions. And that's the world that Patrick entered into as a young slave. It's when he'd lost everything that he tells us that he found God, and he started to pray. He prayed during the day and he prayed during the night. And one night, a voice in his dreams, perhaps in his prayers, said to him, "Patrick, it is time for you to return to your homeland." Patrick took this as a cue to leave, and he said he left almost immediately from captivity. He walked 200 miles to the coast where there was a ship waiting for him. And that ship presumably took him home. After 7 years of slavery, when he'd finally managed to get back home, reunited with members of his extended family, another voice spoke to him, and Patrick describes how he heard the voice of the Irish calling to him through that dream to return to Ireland, this time not as a slave to men, but as a slave to God. And many years later, he did return to become Ireland's famous apostle.
Thank you.
I bind unto myself today the strong name of the Trinity, by invocation of the same, the three in one and one in three. I bind this day to me forever, by power of faith, Christ's incarnation, his baptism in Jordan River, his death on cross for my salvation, his bursting from the spiced tomb, his riding up the heavenly way, his coming at the day of doom. I bind unto myself today. I bind unto myself the power of the great love of cherubim, the sweet well done in judgment hour, the service of the seraphim, confessors' faith, apostles' word, the patriarch's prayers, the prophet's scrolls, all good deeds done unto the Lord, and purity of virgin souls.
From a life of slavery on Slemish, Patrick would eventually set up his base here at Seoul. Today's beautiful church is a sacred pilgrimage destination for those who want to connect with the sense of faith, courage, and deep spirituality that formed Patrick's life. But it's not just the inside of this church that's fascinating. The grounds open another window of medieval history. Dean Henry Hull was my guide.
Thinking specifically about this wall, Dean, can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yes, this wall is part, in fact, it's all that remains of the medieval abbey that was here. There have been a couple of different abbeys, but there was a 13th century abbey which was destroyed by Edward the Bruce, and this wall is all that remains of it.
And I have to ask, what is this rather interesting little building down in the middle of the graveyard?
This is a fascinating building. There have been many different theories as to what it is. Some have thought it might have been a monk's cell in the grounds of the abbey. One person thought it might even have been a reliquary which was inside the abbey building. And a more recent theory is that it's actually a medieval tourist attraction. It was built as St. Patrick's House, so that when pilgrims came to Seoul to see where St. Patrick lived, this was a little house that they could look at.
From Seoul Church, so many of the sacred sites connected to St. Patrick are only a short distance away. The majestic Slieve Patrick with its imposing statue, the monastic site of Inch Abbey, Stroll Wells where St. Patrick bathed in the waters and sang psalms, and of course Down Cathedral where he is buried.
Thank you.
the quiet land of Erin. And now it's a song for Ireland, a song that reflects on peace and on beauty, which we've already celebrated in many forms of music and dance, and in the gorgeous piece by the Cork choirs earlier, and in the quiet land of Erin just now, from Voices of Ireland. It's our turn now, and the ladies of the combined choirs are going to sing this wonderful modern song for Ireland.
Thank you. This is only the beginning of the story. From Down we now travel to Armagh, along a section of the spectacular St. Patrick's Trail. This driving route is lined with a host of sites connected to St. Patrick's life and legacy.
Armagh has been the ecclesiastical capital of Ireland since the 5th century when St. Patrick founded his church here. But from the dawn of its known history, it has been a place where people have searched for something greater than themselves. Today in the city, there are two cathedrals named after St. Patrick, one Church of Ireland, one Roman Catholic.
Well, it's a tremendous honour for me to be Archbishop of Armagh. When I was growing up, I always knew how special this place was. And I think that for people today, to read about St. Patrick and realise that he was just an ordinary person, with all his weaknesses, with all his sinfulness, and yet he really felt that God was calling him. So for me to be here in Armagh, in this great cathedral, and to realise that I'm following in the footsteps of St. Patrick, it's very special indeed.
The Roman Catholic Cathedral is filled with symbols and references to St. Patrick.
As you come in through the front door and you walk up the aisle, you'll see the imposing Great East Window. And if you look underneath the crucifixion, you have two vignettes, one on the left and one on the right. Now, the one on the left is St. Patrick holding up the shamrock, which he used to convert the pagans. It's alleged anyway. He used the shamrock because of the three leaves within the one shamrock to represent the Blessed Trinity, three persons, but only one God.
Sure, God does sing and say.
That's the Grosvenor Chorale conducted by Edward Craig, Shularoon, an Irish song from the 16th century. And there was an honorary member in the Grosvenor Choir tonight, Brendan Monaghan, on Boron accompanying them. We're going to be back shortly with two amazing settings of two of Yeats's most wonderful poems. Oh, Yeats, by the way, was an Irish poet, so that's why he's in the programme. We'll see you after this short break.
Just across the hill, the Church of Ireland Cathedral stands on the site where St. Patrick founded his first stone church in Ireland.
In terms of this cathedral, remember that this is a church that has been here for a long time, but there has been a church here for over 1,000 years. And you get the sense of history and of spirituality of the Irish church that goes back to the very earliest times.
A tour of St. Patrick's Church of Ireland Cathedral takes us through a portal in time. Built in Ard Macha, the Hill of Macha, which gives Armagh its name, this site was given to St. Patrick in the middle of the 5th century by a local chieftain.
We have a wonderful stained glass window of St. Patrick, and it shows Patrick in many different guises, but particularly a wonderful section where he stood by the seashore with the three relics that were associated with him. That's the Book of Armagh, the famous staff of Jesus that Patrick is said to have carried with him to Ireland, and the bell, the famous bell of St. Patrick. So these are priceless treasures of the Irish tradition and of the Celtic tradition.
Armagh Public Library is next door to the Church of Ireland Cathedral, and it's the oldest library in Northern Ireland, founded in 1771 by Archbishop Richard Robinson. It's packed with rare and valuable books, as well as ancient Irish artefacts, gems and coins. It also contains a copy of the Book of Armagh. Dating back to the 9th century, this manuscript includes valuable texts by the scribes Mirku and Tyrcan, revealing much of what we know about St. Patrick's life. The city also boasts one of Ireland's oldest museums. Armagh County Museum is set in the city's beautiful Georgian tree-lined mall, with collections telling centuries of stories about the people who lived here.
Thank you.
Sligo Orpheus Choir, conducted by Austin McManus. And that was W.B. Yeats in one of his more mischievous moods, The Fiddler of Dooney. And I suspect also, given the company we're in, Sligo Orpheus Choir, that it was not just W.B. Yeats was in a mischievous mood. I think you were as well, given the present company tonight. Let me explain, because when Yeats wrote that, he was talking about, when I play my fiddle in Dooney, folk dance like a wave on the sea. My cousin is a priest in Kilvarnet. My brother is in Moharabuí. I pass my brother and my cousin. They read their books of prayer. I read my book in songs I bought at Sligo Fair. And anyway, they all live to a ripe old age and they all arrive at heaven at the same time. And St. Peter has to choose one of them to go through the gates first. And guess who it is? It's because St. Peter likes a good tune. The fiddler got in, the other two had to wait. Sorry, Archbishop. Thanks very much indeed. When we come by, we're now going to hear our very own fiddler, guaranteed access through the pearly gates, Alan McClure, who's going to play not a flippant piece. It's probably one of the greatest Irish melodies ever written by somebody. We have no idea who. It's called The Cullen, and it's the Laurie String Quartet with Alan McClure.
But as well as being a place of learning and Christian significance for 1,500 years, this area was critically important in the ancient world. Navan Fort, just outside the city, is one of Ireland's most famous and important archaeological sites.
What exactly are we standing on here, Patrick?
This is Navan Fort. It's a prehistoric site. It was the ancient capital of Ulster, of the Ulid at Evin Macha. For St. Patrick, this was probably a royal site. It's one of the key ways to convert. If you can convert the king, you make life a lot easier for yourself. So he would have arrived here and tried to convert the king and the Druids who were here. Now, it dates to the Iron Age, so it's pre-Christian, okay? Centuries before St. Patrick. But at that time, this was probably a political centre, but it was also a religious centre. And in my opinion, it was an astronomical site.
And this astronomical dimension to Armagh is still very much in existence today, with the world-renowned observatory and planetarium.
This is a very unusual place. It's an observatory that was founded by an archbishop, namely Archbishop Robinson, towards the end of his life in 1789. And this is a period of time coming at the end of, the Age of Enlightenment, the watershed that separates a very much older view of the sky from the more modern scientific view. So Robinson lived through that period. And as an archbishop, he would have been interested not just in religion, but also in aspects that astronomers take for granted, like questions of existence, questions of how are we here, why are we here, what's the Earth's place in space, and so on. And coming out of that birth, if you like, of the observatory has flourished a vibrant and expanded and growing research institute where we've been at the frontiers ever since the foundation right up to the present day.
That's the terrific Clare Chorale, conducted from Ballyclare, County Antrim, conducted by Sheila Greer, and they were singing The Lake Isle of Innisfree, one of W.B. Yeats' most famous poems. That setting, that tune actually, is the second movement of a violin concerto by a Polish composer called Wieniawski, but you knew that. Where you do know this tune, however, it's probably the most famous of all Irish tunes. It's Danny Boy. Words by an Englishman, F.E. Weatherly, tune written down in Limavady. But I've spent years researching this. It goes back much further. And if you care to scratch onto the surface, you'll find a version of this written for the O'Cahan clan in the 1600s at the Flight of the Earls. But that's a whole different story we won't go into tonight. But for now, let's just enjoy the quiet contemplation that goes with the beautiful song, Danny Boy.
Thank you.
A song now that everyone thinks is a contemporary song, possibly because it was a wonderful hit and a lovely recording by Enya. But it's even older than that. I have a copy of this in a hymn book from the 1800s. How can I keep from singing?
Just the ecclesiastical capital of Ireland. It is a place of learning, culture and history, and a visit here walking in the footsteps of St. Patrick is an unforgettable journey.
You raise me up, it feels like I'm
Ireland has been associated with music for over 1,000 years, and Irish traditional music is loved around the world, but music here crosses all genres. In Northern Ireland, choral music is thriving, with some of the most spectacular venues in the world for choirs and indeed artists of all kinds to perform in. I caught up with John Anderson, a musician and choral director, to find out more. Is Northern Ireland such a great destination for touring choral groups?
I think Northern Ireland is just a great destination, full stop. But if it's for touring choral groups, they experience two things. One is a wealth of places to actually sing. Choirs tour for one reason, and that is to sing in other places. I mean, they're not just going on to, I mean, the sightseeing is important, of course it is, and the history and the genealogy, that all comes into it. But they need places to sing. And I think we are particularly blessed here in Northern Ireland with venues, sacred and secular, that are just absolutely stunning to sing in.
The power of God to hold and lead, his eye to watch, his might to stay, his ear to hearken to my need, the wisdom of my God to teach, his hand to guide, his shield to ward, the word of God to give me speech, his heavenly host to be my guard. Against the demon snares of sin, the vice that gives temptation force, the natural lusts of war within, the hostile men that mar my course, of few or many, far or nigh, in every place and in all hours, against their fierce hostility, I bind to me these holy powers.
Shema Israel.
thinking about Downpatrick Cathedral, John. Why is it so special?
One of the unique aspects of Downpatrick Cathedral is that there is nowhere else in the world where, as singers or as a choir or as a religious group or a touring group or whatever, can you actually stand around the burial place of the saint and perform a simple hymn tune. In our case, the last time we sang there, we chose to sing the greatest of all Irish hymns, Be Thou My Vision. It was just a unique experience for all of us. Itself, of course, I mean, it's a wonderful medieval building, recently refurbished, quite stunning looking now, and the acoustic in it is probably as good as you will get in a small European type of cathedral, and the organ in the building is just exceptionally good.
And the cathedrals in Armagh, John, why would groups and choirs want to come and perform there?
Both of the cathedrals that we're talking about in Armagh, they help the performer give of their best. In the Catholic Cathedral in Armagh, it's a huge space, a very beautiful space. And the thing for performers there is you can actually face directly towards the congregation, or if it's a concert, towards the audience. There is a massive acoustic in it. It's like a big European cathedral. And bear in mind that a lot of the music that many of the choral groups would be singing was written for that sort of beautiful stone building, reverberant acoustic. The Church of Ireland Cathedral, on the other hand, it's smaller, slightly more austere, but just I personally find the simplicity in it just breathtaking.
Behind me.
That's the choir of St. Patrick's Cathedral, where we are coming to you from this evening, appropriately setting us into the last few pieces for this evening with the prayer of St. Patrick, familiar words by now. They were conducted by Colin Murphy, the cathedral organist. We're going to finish on another piece in that same inspirational note, but it's a modern song. It's called You Raise Me Up. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a great pleasure and an honour this evening. I would remind you that this is only the first event in what promises to be a fabulous festival. Do support it here in Armagh, celebrating St. Patrick. The last words will not go to me, they'll go to St. Patrick, but before that, I would like to welcome our principal guest this evening, the Most Reverend Eamon Martin, Archbishop of Armagh and Primate of All Ireland.
What a joy it has been for all of us to gather here this evening in St. Patrick's Cathedral. And it's a huge honour for me to welcome you here. Cad Mila Falcha Roav Gullier, Gaji an Ard Uglish, Neve Padrig, and Shaw in Ardwaha. I'm delighted also that we've been able to experience the gifts, the talents of so many people. As we have celebrated St. Patrick in music and song, prose and poetry and dance, we've celebrated our patron saint, giving him great honor. But of course, as St. Patrick himself would wish, we're giving the honor primarily to God, who gave us all these gifts. Way back in the 5th century, when St. Patrick came to Ireland, he thought he was coming to a place at the end of the earth, because in those days, Ireland literally was at the end of civilization as they knew it. But of course, he would be delighted that people from every corner of Ireland are here tonight in the cathedral in Armagh. And he'd been even more amazed that through the wonders of modern technology, we are reaching people quite literally at the ends of the earth. So it is with great joy that I begin this festival of St. Patrick and encourage all of you to come to Armagh and to be with us as we celebrate our patron saint. Banachtaí na féile Pádraig Oraibh Gualier. God bless you all.
Christ within me, Christ behind me, Christ before me, Christ beside me, Christ to win me, Christ to comfort and restore me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ in quiet, Christ in danger, Christ in hearts of all that love me, Christ in mouth of friend and stranger. I bind unto myself today the strong name of the Trinity by invocation of the same, the three in one and one in three, of whom all nature hath creation, eternal Father, Spirit, Word. Praise to the Lord of my salvation. Salvation is of Christ the Lord.
Christ be beside me. We'll echo those words now in the popular hymn. Ladies and gentlemen who are guests this evening in the audience, you will have found some words on your seats, by the way, when you came in. They're not for information. Stand up. Join us as we sing the last piece of the evening. You'll feel better after this. With the cathedral organist, Colm Murphy, up there. Okay, Colm, when you're ready.